I will tell you a story of why I am the most powerful person in the table and more powerful than you. And that's because I more embrace my ignorance than you embrace yours. Even if I tell you about it, you can't get there because I've worked so hard to get there. I've worked so hard to be dumb and blank. I was the golden boy, and I realized I knew nothing. My passion is the simple journey from not knowing to knowing. A map is a pattern made understandable. Mankind's ability to perceive is a map. My definition of architecture was this thoughtful making of space and place. So information architecture was trying to raise the bar. The organization of information actually creates new information. We're anxious about the fact that most stuff that we call information doesn't inform. The idea of TED was convergence. It's Christmas morning for the mind. I'm a little Jew from Philadelphia. My father made cigars. Nobody went to college. I just wanted to meet the Pope. I strive to discover what it's like not to understand. How to understand what it's like not to understand. In a simple-minded way, I get up one morning, something is interesting to me, I don't understand it, I look for a book that would help me, I look for a TV show that would help me understand. If I find that, I'm satisfied. If I don't find that, I do a book or a conference or a meeting or something about it. It's just all generated by my curiosity. So how do I begin? I begin by going to a terrifying place. I go to this place of not knowing anything about the subject, of wiping my slate clean of anything I thought I knew. The next step is, well then, how do I organize my thoughts? How do I organize what comes into me in this vacuous, airy space that I live? I came up with a notion called latch 20-some years ago when I did a book called Information Anxiety. There's only 5 ways of organizing information: by location, alphabet, time, category, and hierarchy. The organization of information actually creates new information, and it changes the pattern of understanding. People made little animated films on Wurman's theory of latch. Taschen just did a major book.
What I'm saying is what I created non-scientifically 20 years ago has now become accepted as fact. And there it is, latch. And I say, those sons of bitches stole my idea. But then this is all credited. They credit me for the idea. I don't think they made the type of my name large enough, but latch.
It helped me very much when I did my guidebook series.
I had moved to LA and I couldn't find my way around and there wasn't a good guidebook. So I decided to do my own guidebook. All guidebooks were organized by category, not by location. So they had a chapter on hotels, a chapter on restaurants, a chapter on museums, a chapter on the various categories of information. So by changing that in a radical way to organizing everything by location, you didn't have to ask the concierge, where can I eat close by? You could see where the red entries were and they were restaurants, where the black entries were and they were museums, where the blue entries were and they were hotels. I reinvented the guidebook with those. They were a new way of thinking.
I did San Francisco and Hawaii, London, Paris, Rome, New York City.
And then I said, what's the hardest city, the most complex city that I know of? And that was Tokyo. People use this on their ads all over Tokyo. They don't realize that it came from this book, but it's become ubiquitous. It's my favorite map that I did myself.
I've been interested in maps, obviously.
A map is a pattern made understandable.
We are in the pattern business. Pattern recognition is our creativity.
And that's why that's the founding principle of how I look at information architecture, a term I thought up for the AIA in 76.
This is not in a dictionary, but I made it look like it was in a dictionary. The individual who organizes the patterns inherent in data, making the complex clear. A person who creates the structure or map of information, which allows others to find their personal paths to knowledge. The emerging 21st century professional occupation addressing the needs of the age focus upon clarity, human understanding, and the science of the organization of information.
People have different definitions of what information architecture is, and I really don't care. But I do call myself an information architect, but I don't have it on my card.
It's very hard to explain what Richard does. It is especially hard for Richard to explain what Richard does. All of his training as an architect, as a cartographer, as a graphic designer, as an entrepreneur, as a publisher, and as an author, has all been about a passion for making information understandable.
You only understand something relative to something you understand. If I tell you an acre is the size of a football field, just shy of the end zones, the next time you see the word acre, the next time you watch a football game, you'll think, oh, the football field is about the size of an acre. Huh, that's what an acre is. If I tell you it's 43,560 square feet, you won't remember it. I'm interested in the transformation of big data into big understanding.
Today we celebrate a garden of pure ideology.
1984, Steve Jobs comes out with the Macintosh, the famous ad at the Super Bowl, shown only once.
On January 24th, Apple Computer will introduce Macintosh.
An incredible year. I started TED.
If you understand TED, you understand what Richard does.
The idea of TED was convergence. It was the observation that the technology business and the design professions and the entertainment industry were all converging into one thing.
Many people saw these big computers and got a kick out of working with them, interacting with them. The idea that that would become an information tool wasn't something that was originally recognized.
TED. It was a friendly way of talking to information and understanding. It went into our hearts because it was more human, more friendly. It started us on the path of having a conversation with understanding.
I'll tell you how it worked. In the beginning of the TED conference every year, I would say, welcome to the dinner party I always wanted to have but couldn't. I sold it and did the last TED in 2002. I mean, I sold it because I was realizing I was just incrementally doing it a little bit better every year, and that just wasn't enough for me. Sure, there was some regret, yeah. But it would have been more regret if I kept on doing it. It just didn't test my mettle. I wasn't terrified. When you lose your terror and go to your comfort, there's something that, you don't have enough years to live that you should do that. Everything I say is going to go out of style. There's nothing I say that's going to last. There will be no Richard Saul Wurman legacy. But going into knowing you don't have a legacy really makes you just do good work. I'm consistent, if nothing else. But if nothing else, maybe I'm just Johnny One Note. Maybe I'm doing the same thing over and over and over again that looks different because the subjects are different, that looks different because the ideas are different, but it's actually the same thing. How do I strive to understand what it's like not to understand?
So the task that we have at hand is this task of turning this non-information, the stuff that's around us, the data, into an easier way to inform. And that's the journey we're still on.